Kalra.
So, yeah, we are now live.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. Wish you a very, very happy new year, everyone. And this is the first day of the 2022. And we are live on 91st session on Roundtable Expert Meeting Group. And today we have Dr. Shashank Joshi presenting a very important topic on COVID. I will hand over the meeting to Dr. Kalra, former CEO of NABH. Over to you, Dr. Kalra.
Thank you, Saratham. Good morning to all. I welcome you to the 91st session of the Heartcare Foundation of India. And this is today, the 1st January, the first session of a new year. And I will start sharing the screen. And Happy New Year to everyone.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. I wish this year will be the, hopefully, let's say, no more further spikes with the so much morbidity and mortality. And I will just start. I will request Dr. Ashok Gupta to chair the today's session once I finish the basic slides to invite Dr. Shashank Joshi, the today's speaker. We all know that over, world over, in the past few days, there is an increase in cases of COVID. And if we see the WHO weekly report, this data is still 26 December. If we compare the this week data with the prior, it is the American region, Americas, which has contributed. There was an increase in 39% prior in the new cases prior to the prior week. And Africa, in the last few days, 2-3 days, they have shown some decline in their peak they were undergoing after the Omicron, this was diagnosed. It's only 7% increase in cases this week compared to prior week. And Southeast Asia also has shown decline along with the Eastern Mediterranean. And if we see it overall globally, there was an 11% increase in the new cases this week compared to the prior week and 4% decline in deaths. South Africa already has said in the last 2-3 days, it has started showing the decline in the peak, which South Africa started. And South Africa is having a fourth wave undergoing COVID-19. In our country, India, if you see the 30 days data, since the 5th December, the first case of Omicron was reported in India. But the last few weeks, this week, definitely now for 4-5 days, there has been an increasing trend of cases. As Omicron nowadays, as on date, has been reported from 23 states and union territories of India. So almost more than 15,000 cases were reported the last two average on last 2-3 days. And if we see the state wise, Maharashtra is the maximum, then Delhi and other states also have similar results. Kerala, Gujarat, all states, these are showing increase in cases the last few days. Omicron, since 5th December, but the first case reported in India. As per media report, there are total 1,411 cases, maximum from Maharashtra state, 450, Delhi 320, third is Tamil Nadu, then Gujarat and other states. In India, the government has announced even the guidelines for COVID-19 vaccination in children between 15 and 18 years and vaccination precautionary dose which is the same as booster dose for the healthcare workers, frontline workers, and 60 plus population with comorbidities. This was approved by Government of India, Ministry of Health. Beside that, last week, also two more new vaccines, Covovax and Corbivax, which both are the protein part, the recombinant vaccines, as spike protein component and subunits. They are also approved under emergency use authorization. Along with that, one antiviral drug, molnupiravir, was also approved for use in mild and other indications of that will be discussed by Dr. Prashant Joshi. Most of the states have started increasing the restrictions back. Delhi already has activated the yellow code, although now, as on day today, Delhi state is having infectivity rate more than 2%. But still, yellow is being implemented, yellow alert. And all we know as per the table, restrictions we all know, even including the night curfew. Similarly, Maharashtra also has put restrictions, and Tamil Nadu, and many states have put night curfew. So now, coming back to the topic, I will request Dr. Ashok Gupta to further and deliberate on today's topic. And invite Dr. Joshi.
Thank you, Professor Kalra, and it's my indeed a pleasure to chair this session on the very first day of the year. And it's my pleasure to invite Professor Dr. Shashank Joshi to highlight the current situation. I would just like to share one incident. Yesterday, in a TV debate in which Dr. Harsh Mahajan was one of the participants, he did mention and appreciated the Maharashtra government scheme of doing the testing for S chain only in cases which are positive in RT-PCR, not doing all testing because of the cost factor. And I'm sure that has been applauded by everyone. So Dr. Shashank Joshi can highlight on the current situation in Maharashtra and how we can overcome the challenges. Over to Professor Shashank Joshi, please.
Dr. Ashok Gupta, just a comment.
Yes.
A short comment.
Yeah, thank you.
On 1st January, you are the chairman. You will remain chairman for entire year.
Of course. It's a big honor to me. Big honor to me. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashok Gupta. Thank you, Dr. Kalra, Dr. Agarwal, Dr. Bijan, everybody. And thank you, Saurabh and team. I think happy new year to everybody. The year has to start with a positive note. And not with negative note. Though my deliberations today, I am using some slides, but some of them will be data which is not in public domain. So we definitely in Mumbai city are in the third wave. So there is no question asked about it. And this third wave is driven by Omicron. So yesterday in the Kasturba Hospital, which has a genome sequencer, the seventh round of the genome sequencing, which was done in the third week of December, was released. And 13% only was Delta, 55% was Omicron, and rest of the samples were Delta derivatives. So clearly, we can see that in the third week of December, and the fourth week data is awaited now because the week has just ended today. The third week data clearly has shown that 55%, which means the Omicron has replaced Delta in the city of Mumbai at least. And community transmission also was documented. So both these things are now documented in Mumbai city, that there is community transmission which started with cluster outbreaks in from travel related and from high rises and from weddings and from social gatherings. And clearly from that third week, we are seeing an exponential rise in the fourth week, which is this week. And the week started with less than 600 cases. On Monday, we had 1300 plus cases. Yesterday, we had 5,500 plus cases, and today we are anticipating 7,000 cases. And this is also the tip of the iceberg. As we talk, we always fear that Omicron will end the pandemic. And that's not true. This is fresh from the stable. Every Friday we get some bad news, just like Omicron did. The new variant is coming from France, and every origin of those new variants is coming from sub-Saharan Africa. Now, the old variant came from Botswana to South Africa and was picked up in Hong Kong. Now, this is just on pre-Medivirix. It is a breakthrough infection from Cameroon, which is B1.640.2, which has 46 mutations, 37 deletions, resulting in 30 amino acid substitutions and 12 deletions, which is a sister to B1.6.6401. So you can see now a new strain. The genome scientists, their work doesn't stop. This year, they will be focusing on new variant, whether it will be variant of concern, variant of interest, or just a damn squid. Let us hope and pray this is a damn squid. But this is from the French sub-Saharan Africa, Cameroon. And this was picked up by the French genome sequencing labs. Dr. Kalra very beautifully alluded to that New York has exploded and Mumbai is following the New York pattern. So reason I put up this slide is you can see between 28th December, 29th December and 30th December, you can see the exponential rise which has occurred in New York, and the graph of Mumbai is very similar to that of Mumbai. Both are population dense cities, both have a lot of migration, both have a lot of travel, both have high rises as well as slums. So you can see this is the New York graph. And look at hospitalizations, because the key statistics to be followed is not going to be the number of cases. The number of cases are going to be huge. The test positivity rate is going to be high, but it is the hospitalizations. And currently you can see that the rate of change in hospitalizations in New York, and some of it was also shown by Dr. Kalra in his slides, between 20th December, 29th December and 30th December has moved from 6,500 plus to 7,100 to 7,700 in New York City. So this is something which we need to look at. Moving to South Africa, again, Dr. Kalra did a mention, and this is yesterday's data, which was put up by the NICD and this thing, that South Africa also, if you see the test positivity still is at 27%, which means one third of South Africa is still positive. And if you see the on the right-hand side, their hospitalization numbers, still there are a lot of people admitted in different provinces of South Africa. The only place where there is a dip is in the Gauteng province, because people have traveled and people say, like Dr. Tulio Oliveira and others, that South Africa usually is on vacation and therefore we will have to wait for one more week whether this trend of downward trend of South Africa continues. But clearly there is hospitalization. Hospitalization is to the 3 to 4%. So it is not that it is absent or devoid of hospitalization, ICU or ventilators. So this is the Mumbai graph, and this is what was published yesterday. 5,631 cases. I want each one of you all to study this very carefully. Out of them, 4,223 are asymptomatic, which means the contact tracing is high and people are testing much more. So one thing is very clear, that more than 85% of the Mumbai cases are asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic. Hospitalization is only 497, which means the beds which are occupied beds are only 7.8% of the beds allocated to COVID are occupied. So that number, if you see, is very small. So the healthcare infrastructure is not overburdened, which is why there is no lockdown-like strategy which is likely to be implemented. And if you see the death, only one death. In fact, last month, in the month of December, many times in Mumbai, we had zero COVID deaths. And the total number of tests which were done were 47,000 plus. Recovery rate is 97%. Doubling time has dropped down from almost 2,000 days to 360 days. And if you see the various beds which are available, whether it is DCH, DCHC, the CC2 beds for mild and asymptomatic cases, the ICU and ventilator beds, the oxygen beds, the containment zones, the active sealed buildings, and the contact tracings for high risk. And high risk contacts which are also currently there in the CCC. So very clearly you can see that the number is small. Only 11 containment zones, 128 sealed buildings, but contact tracing has been very high. So where is Mumbai today? Mumbai yesterday was at 360 days doubling time. The test positivity rate, which was only 0.4% on 6th of December, on 1st January 2022 is at 11.86%. So you can see the exponential rise in test positivity rate. So that's a red flag. 5631 positive cases, one death, and recovery rate is excellent. So that is where we are. But you know, there are two vertically divided camps in COVID today, you know, and this is a slide which Dr. Eric Trockpal put out. One is the inevitability camp and one is the avoidance camp. So there is one narrative across the world, including India, that this is a mild disease and nothing is going to happen. So what is that inevitable camp? The clinical severity is mild, the less lung and lung to cell virulence from 5 to 6 studies, a vaccine and infection-induced T cells hold up well, so they will protect versus severe disease. Even if you take extra shots, the duration of the extra shot is only 3 months. We can't worry about long COVID. Whether the new pills of Pfizer or Merck will work, we don't need it really, because you know whether you give the pill or not, it doesn't matter. And the transmissibility is very high. So people feel we'll get it over by the hybrid immunity, because once you get COVID. So, you know, there is one school of thought, and you saw one WhatsApp university forward by Israeli professor, that this is like a live vaccination, live attenuated vaccination. So this is that inevitability camp. Ki hoga to hoga, sab log ko hybrid immunity ho jayega, mild disease hai, kuch nahi hoega. So this is one inevitability camp. But there is also an avoidance camp, and you saw our Maharashtra Dr. Vyas put out a red alert that if we get 2 lakh cases by third week of January, and even if you have 1% mortality, 80,000 deaths will happen. So, you know, this is not a disease to be taken out seriously. And secondly, remember, there is still Delta in circulation and Delta derivatives in circulation. So Delta still kills. So we really can't dismiss this current wave that easily. So the avoidance camp feels that it is not always mild. But the data is only on hamsters, mice and culture disease, that is only affecting the upper airways and not the lungs. We have not seen it in human beings. We have to really see how the Omicron behaves in aged population, immunocompromised population. When they don't have a layer of defense, how does it behave there? Is there mortality in that group? Because you see, the hospitalizations and mortality has a lag of 3 weeks. And the third week hit South Africa when they were actually at the end of their vacation. Then, you know, the lot of breakthrough infections are there. But long COVID could be a big challenge. And we won't have the pills like Pfizer, ritonavir, booster therapies. And there are multiple ways to reduce transmission. So obviously, the epidemic wave is determined by transmissibility, severity, and mutations. And we know for sure that Wuhan strain was hovering between 2 to 3 or not. Delta was between 4 to 5. Omicron clearly is coming near measles. So that is very clear cut now. And that we are seeing clinically also. And it has this viral competitive advantage, 500 times more. And that is very, very clear cut. So rapid transmissibility, super mutant, replacing Delta, more transmissibility, clear-cut immune escape, and possible breakthrough. But only thing is severity and virulence is unknown. But early trends are that it is less severe. So that's very clear-cut. These are the features which we all know, which we have talked in the past, that it has more infectivity, it has enhanced transmissibility, and the antibodies, the monoclonal antibodies don't work in Omicron. So clearly we know it is coming from Botswana. Transmissibility is very high. Disease severity is very low, and it escapes vaccine or previous infections. And what Dr. Saab was saying, that in Mumbai, many labs are now reporting the HD deletion, because it is impossible to pick up, you know, genomic testing turnaround time is 2 weeks sometimes, 3 weeks sometimes. Even Delhi has 50% more of Omicron in their genomic testing lab from the LNGP hospital, so which IGIB has done. So clearly, if you have on the RT-PCR and HD deletion, you know that this is Omicron. If HD is present, it is Delta. If it is Delta, you need more aggressive vigilance. You might need monoclonal antibody may respond to it and a lytic cocktail. But and if the viral load is high and if there is H gene present, then definitely you need to hospitalize the patient. So these are some clues which are there, and H gene deletion, many labs are using it. So now when we clinically see as a patient, as a doctor, we have to classify into three modes. One is a very small subset, which is COVID-9 first infection, which means the person has not received a single dose of vaccine and has got COVID for the first time and does not have any antibodies. So this is the very rare now you will get, because you know, this happened in first wave. Now most people are at least got one dose or two doses. So to have that is very difficult. Second would be the most common, which is breakthrough infections. Most of people either had a past infection or had one dose or two doses. And third is, of course, the reinfection, which means that after two doses also, people are getting COVID. And we are seeing most of our cases between second and third. So that is where But the unvaccinated population, how Omicron behaves in them? Are there deaths reported like Imperial College in UK, like United States? We don't know. So the real virulence of the Omicron strain will come from that cohort, which is a small cohort. It's work in progress. We know it's very early days, and we will get data from that. We know it's ultimately going to depend on how our immunity will behave. And I don't want to go into details of it. But most of the COVID, the traditional strain was 80% was early infection, and 15% was pulmonary phase, and 5% was the hyperinflammatory phase. But the graphic for Omicron is 95% is in early phase, and 4% in pulmonary phase, and maybe less than 1% in the hyperinflammatory phase. That's where the clinical staging is, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. And probably there we will get newer antivirals, which are oral and immunomodulatory effects. Who should we really be bothered in this current wave? It's the senior citizens, people who have COPD, diabetes and hypertension, obesity, CKD, immunocompromised states, and organ transplant survivors. So they are the ones we have to there. And we have therapies now. We will have antiviral therapy. Molnupiravir is available in India. We have the antibody cocktail therapy. And then, of course, if there is severe disease, we have everything available. So that's where the disease pattern will go. We need evidence-based. CBC CRP is good enough. Really, if you have the RDW more than 14.5 or a CRP which is rising with a D-dimer, do it every 3 to 4 days. That's good enough. You really don't need to do it. Just monitor the COVID-7 temperature, pulse, respiratory rate, blood pressure, oxygen saturation. That won't change. Whether it is Omicron or no Omicron, this standard protocol won't change. Pulse oximeter is still the key. Particularly in cold season, you need to warm up the hand for a good 3 to 5 minutes. Otherwise, often we have seen that oxygen saturation is even in air conditioned or maybe in North India, there's a lot of cold. You know, the saturation often tends to erroneously be low. So that's very crucial to do it. And still the timetable will remain the same. Acute COVID 14 to 21 days and post-COVID syndrome for 3 months. Right approach, right time, right medication. So that's something which will still remain the same. The main thing is to identify people at risk. So if there is somebody male, somebody senior citizen and has all these comorbidities, more than 8 points on the risk score, then you can benefit from the Delta strain, mind you, from this antibody cocktail. And so therefore, we need to identify who's at risk. If you have cardiovascular disease, hypertension, COPD, chronic respiratory disease, obesity, CKD, diabetes, immunosuppressive disease, receiving immunosuppressive treatment, or senior citizens, you are at risk. So you are at risk to die, whether you have Omicron or Delta, but in Delta, antibody might help. So that's the only thing which we need to do. So we have molnupiravir now. Favipiravir may work because everywhere it may not. Monoclonal antibodies may work only in Delta. Remdesivir has some role that you can give injectable remdesivir for 3 days early in the disease at home. And all other therapies remain almost the same. So inhaled budesonide only for refractory cough more than 5 days. And obviously we need intervention. So molnupiravir is here. It's basically a chain terminator. So molnupiravir is a chain terminator. Good data in the US FDA. And the main thing is why public health and US FDA, Indian FDA, and as well as UK and Europe approved molnupiravir is it decreases the infectivity rate by day 3. So, you know, the transmissibility from that person to other person goes down by day 3. So this is the main reason the Merck drug was approved. And second reason they approved it is 30% reduction in hospitalization and death. But the numbers were very small because compared to the Pfizer trial, that was 86%. It's only 30%. But clearly, it saves lives. So that there's no question about it. Is there Indian data? This is Indian data. Indian data, the viral clearance was quick and fast. So lesser hospital admissions, faster clinical improvement, and better than standard of care. So clearly, we have moved from the old paradigm to the new paradigm. But you will get newer drugs also, newer monoclonal antibodies, newer vaccines, newer immune modulators. And we'll definitely need, but one thing is that Omicron will have 3.8% hospitalizations compared to 10% of the Delta wave, that's South African data. So our goal today is zero COVID deaths, no severe disease, mild manageable endemic disease. So will Omicron be a chain breaker is an open-ended question. And we all wish and pray that this less virulent strain, if it gets into the community, will it be like a natural vaccine? We don't know. Really, it's an unanswered question. Remember, a vaccine is always better than natural infection. For natural infection can still have long COVID syndrome. It can still, we don't know how it behaves in the immunocompromised host and so on and so forth. But really, that is what our goal is. So still on 1st of Jan, we still have unpredictability of COVID. And we still need to have responsible behavior. So I'll stop here. I'll be happy to answer questions. I tried to just give a very rapid overview of what's happening in Mumbai and Maharashtra. Our genomic surveillance of the seven survey which is out, we have also sent samples to IGIB, NIB, and various other national labs. But clearly now, this week, whatever we have seen, we are expecting more than 90% of the spread is Omicron. It's in the community, so there's no question asked about it. So curbs have been put in place, and we have to identify the vulnerable groups. The key feature to watch over the next 3 weeks is going to be the hospitalizations. We have to see when the peak will come. We are anticipating the peak by 15th of Jan in Mumbai. And this will probably, Delhi is usually 2 weeks after Mumbai. That's what we have seen in the previous pandemics. That might come down. It may, Delhi and Mumbai might peak almost similarly. Of course, it has to be more visible. But the hospitalizations, if they remain low, and the severe disease, if it remains low, I think that is the silver lining. So that's something which will be relevant. At the same time, now, of course, the second part of the talk, I think Dr. Garg is going to talk on the vaccine and the precautionary dose. So that's a separate discussion altogether. But it has some correlation with this, because one thing is clear cut, that for Omicron, they believe that if you give the extra precautionary dose or that booster dose, clearly the antibody profile goes up and the disease outcome is likely to be milder in the vulnerable population. So that's the thought process behind it. And that's why globally, there's a lot of push on the extra dose vaccine. So I think I'll stop here. I'll be happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Professor Joshi. Just a essence of your presentation was that Delta and Delta variant are still around and we have to be careful. That's the take-home message, I think, which all of us must stress upon. And the session is open for comments and discussion. Anybody yes. wants to have any point?
Can I pitch in, Dr. Gupta?
Please, Mark.
Dr. Gupta?
Yeah, please, Dr. Agrawal, please.
Please, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Joshi. And as usual, you have given such a comprehensive and the entire presentation is perhaps targeting the situation, what it is in the mind of every one of us. When we talk about increase in numbers, we talk about Omicron versus others, right? And what I understand that though it is not definite, but it seems that the behavior of Omicron seems to be a milder one as compared to Delta. What had been the experience in Africa, where the peak has already reached and now they are perhaps feeling comfortable and their numbers are going down, there the what was the ratio of Omicron versus others, and what was the relationship with the seriousness and mortality?
So very clearly, that's a good question, Dr. Agrawal. There was a total replacement in 10 days of the replacement of Omicron over Delta. So first thing is it rapidly replaced Delta. And probably the same thing will happen by next week. We'll know the results of Mumbai, whether this has replaced within 1 week or not. Second thing is it was milder disease. Severe hospitalizations and deaths were very low in South Africa, even now after 1 month. And therefore, now the condition is on the decline. And in the earlier meeting, which we always have before this meeting, the Commonwealth meeting, Dr. Andrea Coates, who is the one who is a clinician from the Gauteng province in Pretoria, who is also the chairwoman of the South African Medical Association, like our IMA equivalent, she clearly has seen that most of the cases were occurring between 18 to 59. And most of the cases were mild, moderate disease was rare, oxygen requirement was low, hospitalizations compared to say Delta had 10% of hospitalizations, this was only 3%. So, and now they have published their first clinical data in the New England Journal of Medicine day before yesterday. So clearly in South Africa, they have seen a milder disease. However, in UK Imperial College, they demonstrated a little more severe disease. And also problem is that in UK and US, there's a larger pool of unvaccinated population, number
yes.
one. Number
yes.
two, they are still seeing a lot of Delta. And number three, that overall immunity is a little lower in that population compared to the South African population. South Africa might be a little more similar to the Indian population. The other difference in South Africa is, if you remember, Covishield was returned, Astra Maxim was returned from South Africa because beta strain, see, basically, this whole virus has evolved from beta strain. The so-called Omicron. And because Delta came in between, it was hibernating till it went into an immunocompromised host and it came out. So if you see from the evolutionary kinetics, most of South Africa got two vaccines, the Johnson & Johnson and the Pfizer vaccine. So most of them got mild disease. Now in India, we all have been predominantly got Covishield. Most of us have got Covishield, a few people have got Covaxin. Covaxin might have an impact on both Omicron as well as on Delta. Covishield probably has impact on Delta, but we don't know about Omicron. Omicron, it may escape, is the philosophy and thought. So I think two things clear cut. South Africa clearly has seen milder disease, less hospitalizations, less deaths. And number two, UK probably, the Delta still prevails. And in India, we'll have to see over the next two weeks, Mumbai at least. Because Mumbai will give us the first trend. So I think whether it was first wave, second wave, or this wave, we will get clear indications now. Like we are at absolutely at the, you know, we are on the, as you call it, we are on the takeoff mode now. And I think Delhi is also on the takeoff mode. I think Mumbai, Delhi almost are on simultaneous takeoff mode. The gap has been very small. Probably that 2 weeks lag time is there. I feel Delhi is already on the takeoff mode. Only thing is Delhi went into curbs very quick and fast. So this time, you know, Delhi government has been very proactive and reactive and they have just clamped down everything very quick and fast. And Mumbai has been a little, a little more guarded in their approach in terms of clamping down the curbs. But now they have also curbs in place.
Thank you. I think that means we really wish if number has to increase, it should be replaced by Omicron.
Absolutely.
If we have to have increase in numbers.
Absolutely. So if we, this week's data, which is today, Saturday. So abhi aaj jo samples aayenge pure hafte ke jo genome sequencing mein jayenge 95% suppose Omicron aate to it's a good news. But abhi bhi wo ratio 55 Omicron jaise last week ka tha and 45 is Delta derivatives, then you know still we will have hospitalizations and deaths both. So that's the concern. And even if see anything above 6%, including Delhi, hospitalizations go up, it's not a good sign. Because if the numbers go very high, then our system will get strained after 2 to 4 weeks. That's the worry.
That means Professor Bijan Mishra is still in the mind of public. The moment they say Omicron has come into 23 states, Omicron has touched 1,431, right? That means in the mindset of media, the policy makers, our politicians, we are still emphasizing Omicron as a dangerous entry. So can we change the concept of our policy makers? That we don't want anything to come, but if at all it is coming, let's not worry about Omicron.
So that is why, you know, I am always of the view that there should be a very robust communication strategy in terms of reaching out to the citizens, conveying these kind of messages, you know, in a very credible manner, how we can ensure that people can get consulted on phone, or in some other mode where they can get a kind of a reliable information. And of course, a reliable support system. You see, the most important aspect is where are we going wrong or where do we go wrong? Is that we are prepared, we have infrastructure, we know how to deploy it in emergency. We have all the talents, or I would say the skills or the enabling factors, but somehow we don't develop a good communication strategy. You see, like I remember lately, last whole week, there was a debate on television only on discriminatory norms, like how the rallies are being conducted, political rallies are being conducted in an irresponsible manner. And at the same time, state governments are coming with regulations which are not allowing people to move around in a manner they should by observing the protocols, by observing the best practices. So somewhere there is a dichotomy, you know, the leadership is missing in conveying the right message. I do not know who would take that leadership and how it will happen, and how people can chip in, especially, you know, icons who are well respected in the community, whose messages are well appreciated and people follow them. They've got huge followings. So we'll have to engage with them. And that is why I always keep telling the government, but somehow they don't understand. I think they don't want to accept the fact that everything is not science. There is something called also a management practice. You see, it's not all medical science. There is a large need for robust communication strategy and kind of strategies which would manage the activities. You see, unfortunately, I find the management experts are missing in most of the strategy planning. We have got the best of doctors, I agree. We've got best of medical practitioners, but we don't engage with management experts somehow.
Or they don't engage us.
Maybe my suggestion.
I do not know. My contention is the policymakers have the mandate and the powers to do it. The bureaucracy has the powers to engage with the best of talents in the country. I remember when I was engaged in developing the Jago Grahak Jago campaign, it was only because the bureaucrat at that point of time agreed to engage with experts who know the best business of how to reach out and how to develop a good communication strategy. And because they heard us at that point of time, we could create such a robust campaign, multimedia campaign, and the taxpayers' money were well utilized at that point of time. But then somehow again it went for a toss because the bureaucrat retired, somebody else came, they had another thought process, the whole thing gets demolished. It's not institutionalized in our country, unfortunately.
I know. Back to you, Dr. Gupta.
Yeah, I just was saying that like Maharashtra has got a task force, all other states also have a task force for COVID, and maybe the briefing from the task force will be more reliable and efficient data to be shared by the media rather than going by the individual saying or pick up anybody from the medical profession and asking their opinion. So I think it's a right approach to be briefed by the task force about the current development.
I think whatever approach Dr. Joshi was suggesting is right. We need to stop it at any cost because the virulence is very high. And at the end, there might be, because of just population, there might be too many deaths. So best policy is to stop. And in addition, whatever data people say, we are suggesting is it's available. Most of the infections are in vaccinated people. So I think increase the amount of vaccination, and the mask might be the only thing that can protect. All these political rallies, if you see, they're sending even right signal. Because now recently, all politicians are getting infected. So the virus is impartial. So it doesn't spare political bosses. So I think this need to be understood, and we need to address what we called as healthcare managers, which are a reasonably rare species. And we have MBA available in healthcare management. So I think epidemiologists and healthcare managers has to be used to stop these menace. Thank you.
Just one point, both Professor Jamkar and Professor Bijon have made 2 points. One is the need for healthcare managers and management space, which Dr. Aruna Goral also said. Second thing is that I forgot to say this, but last week was our winter assembly session, not this week, the last week. And almost 40 people tested positive. And a lot of Maharashtra ministers are now currently positive. That's what he was alluding to. So virus doesn't spare anybody, whether it is a political rally, religious rally, a social rally, medical rally. If you see the second case which happened in Bangalore, went through the International Indian College of Cardiology. So, you know, if you have a conference, you know, we need to reduce congregations. And that is something, because it's a very rapidly spreading strain. And the numbers, the sheer numbers, see, our worry is not the mildness of the disease. And that's why I gave you those two schools of thought. The mixture of Delta and the large volume, if the numbers are too large, too quick, too fast, even if that 1% it gets hit and there is mortality, that 1% will be huge for our country, because our numbers in our country are very huge. So we need to be a little more responsive. And I think we all have sent messages not to panic. We all are saying, even on national networks, that do not panic. But at the same time, what people are taking that probably misunderstanding is, that approach probably may be true for most of the cases. But in that vulnerable group, we still don't know how it behaves, number one. Number two, if the numbers overwhelm us, like for example, now Mumbai is overwhelmed. 5,000 cases, the primary care doctors are the first contacts. And all hospitals have their resident doctors as well as the senior doctors. They all are getting infected. And they all are having breakthrough infections. So this virus really doesn't have any boundaries, including immunological boundaries. They are all being broken, because all our viruses, all our vaccines are early generation vaccines. So their coverage, what they say, will be broken. So I think, we need to be more mindful and sensitive of this. So I agree with all what has been said. And definitely we need, there may be a medical will, but the health managerial skill sets has to be very, very correct. And we will need some strong handling of this, because the pace and rapidity, see what has happened also, US and UK, based on South Africa, misread the virus. And right now, if you ask me, they are all straight. US has no kits available to do RT-PCR. UK also is trained, and that's why they have moved to rapid testing. So that's the other point which I didn't highlight, but most of them have moved to rapid testing. And CDC has gone ahead and even changed their policy for isolation for work purposes, yeah, which is also not very correct. I think, and we are facing this problem with residents. The other problem is, as a medical professional, I'm concerned, because our first line, which are our resident doctors, all are in the limbo. You know what is happening with the medical profession right now. And that's another problem, that we will not have doctors to look after. So first wave was, we didn't have medicine. Second wave, we didn't have oxygen. This wave, it should not happen that we don't have doctors. No. So that's the other concern which I have. So, though the disease innocently appears mild, the Delta, if we miss, we can still have a challenge. And the volume, if it is too large in the vulnerable group or unvaccinated group, again, we'll have a problem. So I think we should be mindful of both these things.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Dr. Ashok. Sunila has joined. Let her invite her to speak.
Yeah.
First of all, good morning, everyone. And
please, your video is frozen, Dr. Garg.
Yeah, but due to some commitments, I just joined right now. But wish you all a very, very happy New Year. What I just wanted to say, and I could agree no less with, Dr. Shashank, which I was listening to him. But just now, there has got to be a protocol which has got to be standardized for the hospitals. Because you see, even our senior doctors are quite very worried, that they say that each and every patient needs to be, even tested with the rapid test. So this is where we need to have the opinion of the group that, if there are 20,000 footfalls in a hospital, will it be possible? Will it be, or, we need to have kind of a strategy. Like even CDC said that presume everybody like cold and all that. Maybe that, it will be very important to look from the perspective of that even patients who are coming to the hospitals are strictly made to follow COVID appropriate behavior apart from the doctors who are coming. So that is my first point. So we need to come to this consensus, because even our doctors are quite very worried about looking at the patient. So even like we understand that this is not a there's nothing to panic, but at the same time it's we need to be cautious, because also we are seeing a dual spike also of Delta cases and also of Omicron cases. So Delmicron actually is there right now, so we cannot just be very complacent. That is another point. And we also need to talk about the vaccine strategy also, how we like to listen to everyone, like Dr. Shashank pointed out, that how the different states are preparing, with regard to vaccination, which is starting from 3rd. Because you see, like in Delhi, the schools are closed, so they are making the dedicated vaccination points. In Haryana, the schools are open, so schools are being used as the facilities and all that. And then we all know that Covaxin is going to be given to the children, and they have to register from today itself with the help of, you know, either Aadhaar card or their ID, which is there in the school. But then also there will be walk-ins as well. But wherever the vaccines are in school, there will not be a problem. But what we should come out also that, you know, there is a big challenge of immunizing out of school children. We do have a chunk of children which has substantially been added during this period of time, which have dropped out from the school. So we cannot ignore this issue, and this number is quite very high. That is another important thing. And then, you know, we cannot ignore that point also, like Har Ghar Mein Dastak Abhiyan, which was started by the government. So probably, you know, when we talk of elderlies who are going to be vaccinated from 10th of January, and the message has to be very clear that everyone should have received first two doses, whether we talk of healthcare workers, whether we talk of frontline workers, whether we talk of elderlies. So they must have received at least two doses of vaccine at least 9 months back. So that's how, in a graded manner, this precautionary dose is going to be given. But the task is not easy. It is also challenging because of associated vaccine hesitancy. And we realize this, you know, very well in this time when we saw that even our healthcare workers have been very, very hesitant till late. And that's how there is a huge gap also between the, you know, the vaccinations which have been given in the initial phase, and subsequently hesitancy also converted into urgency after the second wave. So these are my initial comments, and I would like to have the opinion of the group with regard to the school dropouts and with regard to elderly's innovative technique for vaccination. Thank you so much. And we'd like to listen to every state also, how they are planning out in their state and, you know, improvising the strategy with regard to children, which is a very, very important and challenging group, because earlier parents were quite very, you know, eager to give vaccination, but when it now actually comes to, they're quite very hesitant also to vaccinate the children. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Garg. Yeah, Dr. Professor Kalyan. Yes.
Yeah, for elderly, what type of a vaccine? Because in the guidelines, this is missing. What kind of a vaccine will be given? The same earlier two doses were given, yes, or will it match?
Yeah,
can we delegate on that?
Yeah, Dr. Kalra, it is the same. The persons who have received Covishield will receive Covishield, and those who have received Covaxin will receive Covaxin. Unless there is a fresh guideline, as of now, because I discussed with ICMR and all that, because of limited supply of vaccines. If you will remember, 90% of our people have received, you know, Covishield, and hardly 10% of them, you know, have received, almost 9.some% have received Covaxin. So if we look from that perspective and we reverse the whole thing, we will not have that much supplies as well. So that is one thing from the operational perspective. So the government is going ahead with that. And also, you see, as of now, it is presumed that this is going to act as a booster, and it will boost up the immunity. That is important. But unless we, and also to children also, we are administering to begin with Covaxin only. So we have to look at the supplies part also. And we do not have, as of now, you know, the subunit vaccines which are there. Because the only DGCA has given the approval, but they are not there as of now with us. So there will be some time before the, you know, those vaccines are available, and then, you know, we can look at that part. But as of now, this is the strategy of the government. The same vaccine has got to be given.
Dr. Garg, can I ask you a question? See, yeah, the science base, if you see, if I had a choice, and now I don't have a choice, but if science based, the subunit vaccine or alternative vaccine would have been a better option.
Definitely.
Like a Covax or a Coronavac. That's one. Second was that giving the same vaccine as far as Covishield is concerned, I can still buy the point, but, you know, homology is a little worse than the heterologous boosting. We know that. But for Covaxin, after two doses, to give a third dose of Covaxin, you know, the boosting may not be very good after
nine. It doesn't make sense also.
Yeah. So because see, Covaxin, the immunogenicity is not as strong. So probably a mix and match in a Covaxin group, which is a smaller group, and Covishield is available in large number. So just like pediatrics, they said only give Covaxin. Probably whether you have taken a Covishield or a Covaxin, you should still take a Covishield. Currently looks to be a more logical approach.
Absolutely.
Of course, this is But point is, all this is so centralized and there's no clarity that we are all at loss. I mean, neither you nor me have any idea what is going to happen on the 10th.
So
there is no, so that's where I feel what Dr. Arun and Dr. Bijon said and Dr. Jamkar said, that we definitely need some health managers putting things in perspective, health planners putting things in perspective, because, you know, the frontline group and the right now, you see the number of hospital staff getting infected in Mumbai city is so large now with the current wave. And I'm sure the same thing will be happening in Delhi also. It's just a matter of time. You know, aage piche maybe 1 week. See, this is, we are stressed out right now. So we need to have something, done quick and fast. And we also know that these vaccines are all early vaccines. I was really thinking that if the nasal vaccine got approved from Covaxin, which is actually Covishield,
Yeah.
That would be a much better option. But as you said, rightly, ma'am, ki these vaccines are not going to be available. And when they are not going to be available, we are actually like, beggars can't be choosers. So, jo mila lena padega.
Haan ji.
So, wo hi hoga. And wo usme kya hoga? Thoda hesitancy bhi hoga. Because and people who have got Omicron, again, they will...
Hello, good morning and happy new year. मैं अभी 10 मिनट में फोन करता हूं, वीडियो वो चल रही है मीटिंग.
डॉक्टर राय, आप प्लीज म्यूट हो जाए.
सॉरी, देयर वाज अ कमेंट बाय सम.
डॉक्टर अशोक, कैन आई कम इन?
सो बट आई थिंक वी, डॉक्टर बिजान, गुड मॉर्निंग. And I feel that, you know, it is better that we have clarified. Dr. Shashank mentioned a very, very important point, that if we have enough of Covishield, why not we give Covishield to everyone? So that can be a recommendation. People who have received Covaxin also will benefit by Covishield.
So after listening to actually both of you, Dr. Shashank and you, see, I am of the firm opinion, and again, I might sound a little repetitive. You know, there is a great need to understand in terms of the best practices in terms of distribution and supply chain management. If we don't understand that, and if we don't try to understand that and brush it under the carpet, we'll always land up in trouble. And that's what you also mentioned, and Shashankji also mentioned, in terms of the data availability on the availability of the products. Now, in terms of the availability of the products, I again see there is a dichotomy in our country. At one side, the manufacturers are crying foul that I have stocks, there is no takers. I have stocks, I have no takers. I'm not even allowed to export. Now, why do we hear these outcries? That means that there is a poor management. So that is number one. Number two, when you talked about, Dr. Sushila, about school children, you know, it is so well organized in our country that everybody knows how many schools are there, who is the principal of the school, who are the owners of the school. We have all the database. Now, just a kind of a developing a networking capacity by engaging with the schools in towns, cities, and even smaller, taluks, will immediately give us a kind of a good, robust supply chain I would say a framework which would allow immediately the children to get covered. It's not a rocket science.
No, Dr. Bijon,
all know how it is to be done. Now, no. I don't understand where the missing link is, why these consultations with the right kind of people don't happen in our country. We keep looking at, you see, I have been attending many meetings within the government in my 35 years of my career in the health sector. And I find the same face there again and again. For heaven's sake, get new people. Get people who are innovative, who are new. You know, today you see in our country the way, you know, the startups have come up. The unicorns have come up. The way they have ideas, talents. We never engage them. We never invite them. Because we always want to see the same old face sitting in that room, talking the same things and drinking coffee. Now, yeah. I just want to understand... Please, for heaven's sake, bring new talents.
Yes, Raman.
Ideas.
Dr. Bijon, you're absolutely right. But the question is, you know, the whole diversity. Like today, if I was to talk on 3rd of March, 3rd of January for Delhi, all schools as per your graded response plan are closed. And, you know, the That is where the thing comes, and that's where it leads to hesitancy. School health scheme is the best platform, we all are aware of, and we have done a lot of initiatives on the platform of school, but there's nothing else. As I said, that around 25% of the children have dropped out also of the school, because they form a very important group for our population as well.
Dr. Sushila, just two minutes. You have all the data. You know the owner, you know the principal, you know the school registration. You know all the children, where they come from, which home they have come from. Even if there is a dropout, you can identify them. There is a system which calls tracing and tracking. So everybody knows it's not a rocket science. It is just a matter of creating a framework, a backbone to reach out. You must have the will to do that. If you don't have the will to do that, you can find 10 excuses.
No, Dr. Bijan, we are looking at the innovative strategies, how to do this with the shortest possible period of time. So I said we have got three groups. One is a group of hesitant parents, which still the ones who were shouting a lot that, you know, we will not send the children. And another thing is that school opening cannot be linked to the vaccination. We are all aware of. Number two is that wherever the school platforms are available, that will be done over there. Number three is that, as I said, that for the children who are dropped out, we know the link. But you see, the children may have dropped out long back also. And then we do have child observation homes also. So that is where we need to, that's what I said, we will be having innovation across. Because you see, each state is also deciding its own way, which is also important. So that's what I was telling. Thank you.
Yes, any more comments from Professor Kalra?
Dr. Rai.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. And first of all, wish you all a very, very happy new year. And may God bless everyone and make them free from the sufferings which we all had in 2020 and 21. Now the question of that today, I heard everything. There are some confusions are going on. As far as people are advocating about the cocktail vaccination also, Shashank has definitely told that if somebody has taken the Covaxin, he should take the Covaxin only. But the reports are also there. If somebody has taken the Covaxin and the third dose they have taken of the Covishield, they are getting more antibodies than anything other. Second thing is, Dr. Sunila has told about the dropouts. It's a very, very logical question, because more than 25% dropouts there, and there are other persons also we have to target to them. Then the third is definitely the way the cases are increasing. Our role models are our politicians. When they are defying all the protocols, how you can force the public? How you can force the public? And I'm surprised to say that all the political parties has met the CEC, and they have requested to go ahead with the scheduled electioning. Why the hell we are discussing all these things? Because when the people sitting at the helm of affairs are bent upon ruining the country, then what is the need of that one? Nobody is asking the task force whether we should go. The task force, one word should be taken for granted. No, we will not have the elections for another 2 months. And heaven is not going to fall with that. But yes, our priority should be only to save the population, to save the health of everybody. So there are few points, and as already we have discussed in the past also, whatever we are discussing, we should immediately send to the task force and to the ministry also. This is our observation, and these are the results which we have done our analysis from the data of the South Africa, from the data of the Europe, and from the data of the England. Why they are suffering so much? And it's really surprising. Only yesterday, more than 98,000 cases of Omicron in England only. And that too, a population of only 7 crore. And our country is having a population of 135 crore. What will happen to us? We are still worried. But third thing definitely is there. Every time we all doctors are saying, don't worry, don't be panicked. It's okay, it will go. I think we will have to warn them. Yes, if you will not take precautions, you are going to land in a soup. This is my only observation, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rai. Any more comments?
May I come in?
Dr. Gar, for a booster dose, is it better to have a Pfizer vaccine?
That we, Dr. Shashank will also be able to answer that, but we, as of now, you see, we do not have any RNA vaccine with the good storage, this thing. That is important. That's how earlier also we could not do that. So that is one thing which puts us back. But the, now, you know, we will have our own, you know, mRNA vaccines also, which will be stored between 2 to 8 degrees centigrade. But till that point, you know, there is a long gap also. And then again, if you initiate the formalities, people who are going out are taking definitely Pfizer vaccine, those who have been vaccinated, you know, with our co-vaccine and all that. So that is important to understand that as of now, we do not have any, you know, mRNA vaccine, which can be stored according to Indian conditions.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. I agree with Dr. Rai that we should follow co-vaccine with the Covishield. So there is mix and match is always better. Number two, what Madam Garg said is very correct. See, don't rush for that Pfizer mRNA vaccine. Pfizer mRNA vaccine for adult young population below 30 may not be safe for the heart. We don't have good data to show that. So that's number one. So if I have a child, I would not give a Pfizer vaccine to that child because mRNA platform is a new platform. What we need to do right now is just do simple mix and match. See, our hepatitis B vaccine has been a very old vaccine. It is a subunit vaccine. So India has made through the biological Evans and through Serum Institute Covax, which is a subunit vaccine. A biological Evans has made Cobrevax from the University of Texas. These are two good vaccines which can be given as an additional dose. If you really want to boost, we have a Zydus Cadila DNA vaccine, which is also equally good, as good as the mRNA platform. We can give that. We have Genova coming up with the mRNA vaccine, and we have a nasal Covishield coming up also from the Covaxin stable. So don't rush and get enamored by Pfizer. Remember, Israel gave 2 Pfizers, 2 boosters, and still landed up with Omicron. And now they have yesterday reported a first case of Flucron, which means a combination recombinant virus of flu and Omicron. Yeah. So remember, giving too much of mRNA vaccine too often may not be good idea. And mRNA is like that molnupiravir, like mutagenesis. You might actually breed another strain. So, and all the countries which have taken Pfizer vaccine are right now being battered. So, I am not so sure the last word on vaccine is out. These are all early generation vaccines. We are all in experimental mode, if you ask me. So, let us pause, use science, do mix and match. I agree that if somebody, see, minus 70, India may store karke, or distribute karke, administer, next impossible. So, Pfizer to dena bahut mushkil hai. Moderna ka bhi same problem hai. But Moderna का storage थोड़ा सा minus 20 तो फिर भी कर सकते हैं.
Minus 20, yeah.
ये बाकी के जो vaccine आ रहे हैं mRNA, वो storage capacity and ability to go to the rural area is possible. तो mix and match will be the strategy. I feel that the nasal vaccine probably looks to be the sterilizing vaccine. Mucosal immunity will be generated. This is a nasal virus. Whether you like it or not, it is an airborne nasal virus in the upper airways. So if you ask me. I would put, if I had a choice today and I had to take a booster or extra dose, probably I would go for a nasal drop. Probably. Yes. That's what I would do. I have taken 2 Covishields. I didn't have a choice. None of us had choice, actually, very honestly, you know, but it was voluntary. See, government also has been very mindful. They gave it voluntary to us. We had to decide whether we went in for it or not. That would be my choice. If I don't have that nasal vaccine, then what is my next best choice? Probably an mRNA, not available, DNA, not available, subunit vaccines, not available. Then mix and match, if I'm on Covishield, should I take Covaxin or should I just take Covishield again? That's the option which is available. So I have to look at hierarchical evidence base, hierarchical option and availability. Now, the common man can't understand so much. So or neither the doctors, they will be clamoring. So they have to either open it and not centralize it. See, now what is happening, it is like RNTCP, like TB. Everything is controlled by the COVID app. So actually, if you ask me, beggars can't be choosers. We are going to be not given any choice. We have to accept what they give us and take it or leave it. That is the only option we have. Though we are a democratic country, the vaccination policy in our country is a dictatorial policy. I'm sorry to say this, but that's a fact. And that's what, but it's okay. Because, you know, they are looking at a larger public good. They are looking at a larger public good. So they may have their wisdom in that. they are looking at larger public good, but I sometimes feel a little anguished. Had they put it out in private sector, I could have gone and picked up my choice and my precautionary dose. I think that could have been reasonable. I think they have been a little harsh. I don't know what their reason. I would definitely like some comments from Dr. Kalra and Dr. Bijon, because this hurts sometimes as doctors, you know. I mean, is it really after being in India, coming from US, is it really worth all this sometimes?
Dr. Sashank, I must congratulate you. You have been very forthright. You have reminded me of Dr. Agarwal today. You know, I'm telling you very frankly, you have that mission mode like Dr. Agarwal in you, which I heard today. You know, I used to get these kind of messages from Dr. Agarwal. And he used to motivate me all the time that aap please boliye, because ye log hum logon ko nahi sunte hain. You see, and this is where today what you spoke, it is golden words. You know, let me tell you, I would like to spend offline with you on this, and we will find out a strategy that why, because I have always said, you know, giving options to the citizens is the best which the country can do. Choice, you know, that's our birthright, to be given correct, the right choices, and then leave it to the citizen to decide which one they want to take, but provide the choice. Don't be dictatorial. And I really appreciate your words. I will talk to you offline on this.
Thank you.
Okay.
Dr. Verma,
to please.
Please, Dr. Verma,
for a minute. Yeah, Dr.
Verma,
please.
So I want to know, in the context of the immediate last few minutes discussion, has the phase 3 trial of the Covaxin nasal spray been approved? I mean, has it started? Because there was a report about 10 days back in the press that they have applied for approval. Bharat Biotech has applied for approval to the government for commencing the phase 3 trial of the nasal spray. So has that actually begun? Because everyone, all the experts seem to be of the view that that is what will be most effective. So that is one thing I would like to know. And also comments on the couple of things. One was what Dr. Sunila Garg was suggesting about stricter protocols for patients in hospital. But I saw this yesterday. I had gone to Moolchand, which is one of the larger hospitals in Delhi. And especially the reception area where the patients line up, for payment and registration, things like that. That is where, apart from no social distancing, masks also, you know, those loose masks there itself, as soon as you enter the hospital, you get that first exposure. So that is something that has to be put in very strictly by the hospital managements themselves. Because whatever protocols you put in, they have to be followed on the ground seriously by the hospital managements themselves. And about the school dropouts, of course, that will only be possible from the school registration facilities. It's very easy to find from the schools what are the number of school dropouts, who are they, where they live, mobile numbers of the parents. Everything is now registered there. So that the state governments will have to make that little effort to communicate with them about the importance of getting vaccinated. One more thing I would like to ask is about AstraZeneca, that is Covishield. That was banned for younger population in many countries, below 55, below 45 in Canada, below 55 in Germany, things like that. So is it wise for us to give Covishield even to this younger population? Because even between 18 and say 45 or so, because people do seem to have reactions from whatever one hears, especially in women. Young women seem to have had more reactions to Covishield than men. So this is what
I was saying. Dr. Joshi, anybody wants to respond?
Dr. Garg can give the answer also, but I will tell you that, madam, Covishield had challenges all throughout. So no question.
If I see
your concerns you are expressing, Covaxin is much more safer. So from a safety standpoint, Covaxin is much more safer. From an immunogenic standpoint, Covishield is much more immunogenic. So that is how it is. Madam Garg.
Yeah, another thing is that you started about the phase 3 trials of nasal vaccine. As of now, it has not been initiated because they had sought the approval, by till 22nd of December, it was not done, and these have been the, you know, lean period, so this has not been given as of now. What I can see, maybe we can start, that will be initiated in this January month. That's what is my total information. And another thing which you started about the school part, what I would like to say is that many years of working in schools, and the lastly also I'm still working on smokeless tobacco in different parts of the country, and that's where we are, there are children which have two kinds of children, which are school dropout, which are skill also, you know, children who have never gone to school, which are there in child observation homes and all that. To trace them in child observation homes is easier, to trace the children in schools is easier. But as I said, we will have to, every state will have to use with the school health department the innovative schemes, which we, because we have been working with schools since long, long time. In my little experience of 40 years in public health, that's what I have got to say. So I feel that, you know, we don't have to worry about that. That's the job of the authorities, concerned authorities. So that will be there. My only concern has been the issue of vaccine hesitancy. So that's where, even in children, as I said again and again, that, you know, parents were demanding this. And everyone thought, you know, and the schools have been closed for this very reason. And especially, you know, Delhi's health education minister went on record to say the schools will not open till children are vaccinated. It was only the advisory which we gave us, and then following it, the schools will open. So this is one thing we have to keep in mind, that, you know, that we have to address the hesitancy in schools, and as has been pointed out by Dr. Shankh, that we need to go for Covaxin, which is a wholesale vaccine. It's a superior vaccine, and it is much more safer in children. That is important. That is it. And definitely immunogenic response is maybe better in Covishield, but it is when we have, you know, I feel that a lot of, you know, adverse events following immunization with Covishield, they have been underestimated. Like I was talking to Dr. Anna in Tanda, one of the ladies had transmyelitis following, you know, administration of Covishield, but then, you know, the system underplays. But you have to be really vigilant as to following, and you have to associate. Even many cardiac clinics have started recording, you know, the events for the patients who are coming to cardiac OPDs and for hospitalization about the vaccination with regard to, you know, any of the vaccine with regard to, you know, COVID-19, and especially, you know, this has been observed with regard to Covishield. So the institutions have also become vigilant. Thank you. Is there any other question which you asked and which has not been answered?
No, thank you. But thank one thing is there about why is not this is such a priority according to, you know, all of you, the Covaxin, that the nasal spray will be better. Then why is, again, you know, why are the authorities sitting on that approval? That is the urgent thing. Maybe we should flag it in our if we are recommending anything.
Yeah, and because whenever there are international collaborations, you know, it takes time for, you know, the permissions to happen. But definitely this is going to be the much better vaccine, you know, in the coming year. These four vaccines which are already there in phase, we will have rather surplus vaccines, but that doesn't mean we go upon taking boosters upon boosters. Rather, there was one CDC guideline also that primarily we should stop giving all, and, you know, we should not panic, and we should rather treat it as a simple flu that is there. But then, you know, it's a question of science. We cannot just leave it like that. And we have to, again, be watchful of the situation and watchful of any, again and again, this has been pointed out, of any kind of, you know, events which involve, you know, clustering of people, like whether we talk of elections, whether we talk of, you know, our other, they're saying, you know, whatever you may say, we may talk 10 things over here, but the ground reality is really different. Whether you talk to talk about markets, go to buy vegetables and all that, things are really different. When we say don't panic, doesn't mean that, you know, you become complacent and stay like that. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
One minute, I will take one point.
Madam, just to answer one thing. The biggest challenge we are facing in vaccine trials, one of our centers is a vaccine trial center, is recruitment of patients. See, the point was what Sunita ji is saying is very correct. Ki abhi recruit karne ke liye patients hi nahi hai. And unvaccinated population milta hi nahi hai. And jinko COVID bhi nahi hua hai last 6 mahine mein, aur jinko, so it's a big problem also recruiting patients. So doing good science
also is not easy. It's like a catch 22 we have got into, and we definitely, that's where again we need good policy, good health planning, good foresight vision, because we knew that this is coming in. So we definitely need a structure protocol plan in place. For example, our mix and match protocols could have been done almost 6 months back. So by now we would have had data, and we would have been able to tell with certainty ki kaun sa dena hai, kaisa dena hai, kya dena hai, data kya hai. So if we had all that, no, it would have been much easier, ma'am. That's all I want to say. But right now, I think we are sitting in good space for two reasons. Number one, काफी लोगों को एक्सपोजर हुआ है तो नेचुरल इम्यूनिटी है, काफी लोगों को दो डोज मिले तो सम डिग्री ऑफ रीजनेबल प्रोटेक्शन इज देयर. द ओनली चैलेंज इज नाउ व्हाट शुड बी द नेक्स्ट डोज, एंड देयर वी शुड हैव अ लिटिल मोर चॉइसेस एंड लिटिल मोर एविडेंस.
Do you think we should recommend booster after 6 months instead of 9 months to the vulnerable population? Is that in place? There is no exception for people with, for example, organ transplants, those kind of immunocompromised people. They have to wait 9 months, minimum 9 months after the second dose. Should they not be given after 6 months? What do you suggest on that?
Dr. Balbir, earlier it was also debated, as Dr. Shashank pointed out, that each one of us, by and large, even after receiving two doses of vaccine, has had a frank clinical infection or a subclinical infection as well. So primarily, if you see each one of us, that's why the number of cases as compared to West has not gone up like that, and whatever we are getting are comparatively very mild cases as well. But then having said so, when the data was analyzed, it was felt that, we can wait for 9 months. That is important because at least, we can give it to our healthcare workers, frontline workers, and immunocompromised, as you already mentioned. So this is as of now, which has been decided. And still you will find that amongst that also, when you will be looking at particularly elderly population and all, we should make sure that they have received at least two doses of vaccine, which is also when we'll go for field launching of these precautionary dose, there will be a lot of challenges with that also. We have to, that's why we started this Ghar Ghar Dastak Abhiyan, but we have to make sure that at least after 9 months also they get this vaccine. That is the major point with us when we go for the field launching. Thank you.
I think we have to conclude the session, Professor Kalda.
Yeah. Please, sir.
Just reminds me of two statements of Dr. K.K. Agarwal, that if you want a a la carte, go for Covishield, and if you want a buffet, you go for a Covaxin. I think that is something which has been discussed also. Thank you, Dr. Shashank Joshi and Dr. Garg, for giving us such an elaborate presentation and make us a little wiser than what we were before. Over to Dr. Kaldana.
I think
you reminded me again of Dr. Agarwal, I challenged him. I said, aapne humko bola ki aap intezar karo wo vaccine ke liye, aur aap jaake Covishield le liya. To bole nahi, humko malum tha ki humko milega nahi, to hum le liye. Aapko milega to isliye aapko bole aap ruke raho. Now, this is where we go wrong. There is a lot of discrimination which goes on. Now, he wanted Covaxin, but he couldn't get, he had to go for Covishield immediately. So this is what he confessed to me, and, such a lovely person.
Luckily, I followed his advice and got Covaxin. But anyway.
Same here. He pushed me. He literally pushed me. He said that, Covaxin mil raha, please jao. And then I remember when I became a victim after the first dose, he was the person who pushed me into the hospital. I mean, he actually literally told my family that inko ghar pe mat rakhiye, inko please bhejiye hospital mein. Aur hamare piche piche wo gaye, and then we never saw him.
Just one final question I wanted to ask Shashank. Is there any role of a CRP or antibody testing before we go for a booster? We are fully vaccinated and we come all into comorbidity with age, diabetes, and hypertension. Is it safer to do that or just
antibody testing? No role. CBC, CRP, IgE, if you have history of anaphylactic reactions.
Otherwise, we can go statewide. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think let's conclude the session.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Today we had
Happy New Year once again to everybody.
Happy New Year, better New Year. Healthy
New Year. That is important.
Let it be healthy New Year. Yes.
Let's keep meeting. I only pray to Almighty God to free everyone in the world from the sufferings of 2020 and 21. We should not have the sufferings in 2022.
Yes. I'm happy we all remember Dr. K.K. Agarwal today.
Thank you, bye-bye.
Dr. Shishan, Dr. Sunila, and all participants. Thank you, see you again on the third week of this month.
Thank you.
Thank you.